In Asia, Hong Kong is well known for its modern cityscape, but few people are aware that it sits on a volcano. The volcano in question is no ordinary volcano, as it produced one of the planet's largest explosive eruptions, specifically a single massive supereruption. In fact, Hong Kong is built directly on top of igneous rock that represented this ancient, now extinct volcano's magma chamber. Today, it is exposed as various outcroppings of granite in the vicinity. Yet, travel a mere 11 kilometers to the east and you reach the edge of an unusual geologic region that contains highly abundant hexagon-shaped columns of rock, some of which are as much as 3 meters or 10 feet wide and 30 meters or 98.4 feet tall. These all formed in a single cataclysmic eruption that created a vast 18-kilometer or 11-mile-wide depression in the ground referred to as a caldera. This represents what is known as the High Island Caldera. Although this volcano has long been extinct, the sheer power of the ancient supereruption in question becomes clear when you realize that all of the aforementioned tens of thousands of hexagonal columns of rock represent thick rhyolitic ash beds placed in its singular caldera-forming eruption. The High Island Caldera is located in far southeastern China, where its complex encompasses much of the special administrative region of Hong Kong. The outline of where associated igneous rock can be found is shown on screen, but this does not represent the original caldera rim. As, due to extreme tilting of around 30 degrees to the east over millions of years, what used to be the top of the caldera is today located on the eastern edge of the complex, and the bottom of the complex representing the original magma chamber is now exposed on the surface on its western edge. The story of this caldera begins 148 million years ago during the late Jurassic period. During this period, southeastern China represented the edge of a north-to-south trending volcanic province that produced numerous and frequent high-volume explosive eruptions. These major eruptions formed multiple smaller calderas of variable sizes, each of which may have been as much as a kilometer deep. The cause for all of these major eruptions related to the area's geologic setting. Offshore, more than 100 kilometers to the east, a tectonic plate collision was ongoing. One plate was being subducted underneath another, from which melted material migrated upwards, forming a chain of volcanoes. However, this plate subduction also caused mantle convection to occur further back. Material in the mantle was thus sent upwards. Over tens of thousands of years, beginning 141 million years ago, one such massive body of magma slowly expanded in volume at around 8 kilometers depth. During this time span, it generated a few eruptions on the surface, forming lava domes, but the majority of magma stayed at depth. This magma chamber eventually reached a volume of several hundred cubic kilometers, if not more, after which something triggered a large volume of material to rush towards the surface. As the magma erupted from a lengthy fissure, powerful explosions occurred which created a loud roar. As viscous rhyolite lava and ash was violently ejected out of these vents, the eruption became more energetic, releasing a sustained column of material at a rate of several million cubic meters of rock per second. As a plume of ash shot 50 kilometers or 164,000 feet into the atmosphere, part of the eruption column collapsed, producing highly energetic gas currents referred to as pyroclastic flows. These flows were up to a kilometer in height and seemingly defied local topography by traveling over mountains and reaching more than 100 kilometers distant. After a several-day-long intensive eruption, the underlying magma chamber had been drained to a point that the rock overlying it collapsed downwards by 1,850 meters, forming an 18-kilometer-wide caldera. In total, 1,300 cubic kilometers of tephra was ejected in an eruption 30% larger than the most recent supereruption of Yellowstone. Some areas were buried in more than 400 meters thick of rhyolitic ash and tephra in the course of less than a week. The aforementioned ash was thickest within the caldera and took many years to cool. As it cooled, largely from the top down, the material contracted towards a series of evenly spaced centers. Since the best way to accommodate this contraction was to form a series of near 120 degree angle cracks, this process eventually formed polygon shapes, primarily six-sided hexagons. These hexagon-shaped cracks then propagated downwards, as once the process began, going further down required less energy. By the time the cooling had completed, many hexagonal columns had been constructed. Thanks for watching. If you would like to request a specific topic, please leave a comment below. As a final note, I would like to thank this channel's patrons on Patreon and channel members on YouTube.